Well, good afternoon. I'm going to kneel and have one more word of prayer before I start. Our gracious Father in heaven, we kneel, not out of habit, but confessing our great need of thy presence and the blessing that you have for us. We ask that you will send your spirit in a greater way to abide in this room, and that as we look at your word on the screen and look at these pictures, we ask that your spirit will whisper to our hearts and you might show us how we can come more fully into an alignment with your will. Lord, we long to be united with you more closely. We see our need at this late hour, and we ask that this Sabbath's message might be such as would lift us up into heavenly places and would show us the work that we need to do in order to receive the blessing. We're thankful now for the presence of your Holy Spirit. Let him abide with us throughout the day, we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We are continuing our mini-series on three of the parables of Christ. The title of this one is The Sower, the Seed, and the Heart Soil. In Jeremiah 15, 16, it says, "Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of mine heart." It's our prayer that the word will not just reverberate in our ears, but that we will actually feed on them this morning, and that they will give us one of those great fruit of the Spirit that love, joy, and peace. The Bible is not only a book that has the spiritual medicine we need for our problem, the Bible is also perhaps the greatest diagnostic tool for those with spiritual illness. It helps us to see what our problems are, and we're going to look at a parable that actually begins to unfold before the hearer, those that whose minds are worked by the Holy Spirit, the problems that lie within our mind. In order to study the Gospels, Bible scholars have compared lists of all of the teachings, all of the miracles, all of the events in Jesus' life, and they call those lists that they compile and integrate together, they call them a harmony of the Gospels. And if you go into the library and look at various harmonies of the Gospels, where they're comparing the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, with the book of John, you'll find that they list the orders of events differently. They actually list the numbers of miracles differently. They even list the number of parables differently. Does anybody have any idea how many parables Jesus spoke? Take a guess. No penalty for a wrong answer. What would you say? 75. Somebody else? 100? Okay, actually, I've looked in several different harmonies of the Gospels, and in each one, I found a different number. And I found some things on a list of a harmony of the Gospels that I had a lot of confidence in, that they were missing some of the parables, even parables that start with the words, "And he spake a parable unto them," saying. They left that one, a couple of those out. But as I've compared different harmonies of the gospel, I have counted a total of 47. And here on that graphic there on the upper left, you see that the book of John has almost none of the parables of Christ. And which book has the most of them? The Gospel of Luke has the most parables. How many miracles did Jesus perform? Anybody have any idea? Just as there's actually 35 miracles that are recorded in the Gospels. And again, you can see there that the book of Matthew and the book of Luke records the most miracles. The parables of Christ actually can be divided into categories. They actually group together. And you will notice that there's a lot of different categories for the the parables. Some of them talk about the character of God. Some of them talk about the largest number of them talk about the plan of salvation, the plan of redemption. And the next largest number talks about the transformation of character and what we need to be doing as we're awaiting the Lord's return. The parable that we'll study right now for the next 35, 40 minutes is a parable that comes in the category of receiving truth. Jesus told, out of those 47 parables, he told five of them about the importance and the work of receiving truth. And it's always difficult to try to teach a story in the Bible that people are very familiar with, but we're going to attempt to do that this morning, this afternoon. This parable of the sower is found in the three synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and we will bounce largely between Matthew 13's account and Luke chapter 8. And we're in both of those, and all three of those accounts, you find Jesus telling the parable, and then he comes back with his disciples who have questions, and then he gives an explanation of that parable. And we're going to look at Jesus, the words that he used to tell that part of the parable, and then we'll look at his explanation, and we'll see that in a couple of the other books, he adds more detail that's not in the most read Matthew account. It says, as was read in our scripture reading this morning, that he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow, and when he sowed some seeds, fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Who is the sower? Okay, you might have to Chris say a little bit. Who is the sower in the parable? The answer is that Christ is the great antitypical sower. He is the ultimate sower in the parable. In the book Christopic Lessons, again, on page 37, it says, Christ came to sow the world with truth. It says there in yellow, middle of the paragraph, that he was a sower from a higher world. And he's the one that came to fill the earth with the truths of heaven. But we also, in a sense, are also to be his accomplices in sowing. What is the seed? There's the answer right on the screen. Luke 8:11 says, the seed is what? The word of God. And that really underscores, you know, when you come to church here and you're getting the Bible every Sabbath taught to you, you can possibly take for granted that in other congregations, they are not getting the Bible. I don't know if you're aware of that or not. I have visited many churches, and I have sat in churches, and I have sat in churches which I thought I was going to get some word. And at the end of the sermon, I had two Bible texts listed. I had a blank sheet and two. There was only two Bible texts in the entire sermon. In some places in the world, they have clown-led worship, and they have all kinds of things going on in churches, and not everyone is getting the seed of God's word sowed in their mind on the weekend. Part of the problem is that most people, unfortunately, depend heavily upon getting whatever word they get on the weekend. And actually, the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 28 that if you want to understand doctrine, that you actually have to feed for yourself. It says in Isaiah 28, verse 9, whom shall he teach knowledge, and whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are what? Weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. And we know that a church in the Bible is represented as a woman. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 2, it's just one of the many texts that show that. And the Bible says that if you want to get knowledge, if you want to get doctrine, you have to at some point stop looking for the church to teach you. Does that make sense to you? That you have to start learning. When a child is weaned from the breast, how does that child eat from that point forward? They have a little bowl, they have a little spoon, and they learn how to feed themselves. And we have people that have been in the church for decades, and they really are getting almost all of their teaching from the sermon on the weekend. They're getting their teaching from a CD or a television broadcast instead of getting the Bible out and learning how to feed. The other thing that this text brings out very clearly is that we have to get off of the milk and start to get onto more solid food, some things that are deeper. If you're depending upon someone to come and give you some food and you're not learning to study for yourself, you're going to have problems. Unfortunately, many people in the church are like babies. The Bible in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12 says, "For when for the time ye ought to be what? Teachers." I want you to read, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become. What happens when you have to have someone teach you? It says you become such as have need of milk. You just get to a point where you really have a low tolerance for deep things, that when people start to have a more lengthy, involved, meaty study, your mind just starts wandering. You don't have the capacity to follow. We're not going to spend much time about this, talking about this process this morning, this afternoon, where heaven is broadcasting seeds. In the Bible, there's this plenty of choice seed there that we have to spend time receiving. But in Psalm 16, verse 7, it tells us one of the prime times for you to study the scriptures, and that is at the beginning of the day. And the day begins when? It's at bright daylight hours or evening hours? When does the day begin? It begins at evening. And in Psalm 16, verse 7, it says, "I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins, my mind also, instruct me in the night seasons." One of the best times to study the Bible is in the evening. In the evening, push things aside. Push things aside. Turn the cell phone ringer off, and turn off the electronic gadgets that are bombarding your mind. Put the iPad and the tablet down, and take out your Bible and pray and ask God to speak to you in the evening. Well, we're not going to spend time. Those first eight slides were the first part of that parable that we're not going to spend any more time talking about. That is, who is the sower and what is the seed? The most of the time of our talk this afternoon is going to be on the part that Jesus emphasized the most. The title of our message is "The Sower, the Seed, and the Heart Soils," but what we're going to talk about the most is that variable, understanding the heart soils. Now, from the very beginning of the human race, man was created of what substance? What were we made from in the beginning? And still made of today. We are made of dirt. And it's interesting that God, Jesus, in his parable, he refers to the mind, the heart, as soil. He likens the heart to soil. And that's because one of the reasons is because this is what we were made from in the beginning and are made of even today. And it's interesting, the Bible says in Genesis 3 that after man sinned, the soil, not the soil that was in Adam and Eve, but the soil that they walked upon, had a actual physical change. The Bible says clearly that because of sin, it says that cursed, that's a typo, is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. In Genesis 3:18, God said, thorns also and what? Thistles shall it bring forth. So after man sinned, this very familiar story at the beginning of the Bible, after man sinned, there was a change in the plant life, the vegetation world, and that now man was in a fallen state, and now his physical environment would mirror that fallen state, and that in God continuing the command said, "In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread till thou return unto the ground, the same ground that's bringing forth thorns and thistles. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. So it's interesting that God, he cursed the ground. He says, you're going to have to work the ground, and eventually you will return back to the ground from whence you were taken. Now, why did God cause the plant life, vegetable kingdom, and the earth to become cursed? Why did he curse the ground? Why didn't he just say, okay, Adam and Eve, you sinned, the serpent deceived you, so we'll curse the serpent and curse you too. But why was the ground cursed? Why did he cause these pathological changes to take place where the clay now would get really hard? It had to be tilled, and then thorns and thistles would come up. Here's an interesting answer. One author says that the ground is God's illustration of the human heart. And after the fall, God saw that the perfect garden could no longer teach man the lessons he needed to learn. He must have a garden that would be a fit illustration of what? The changed condition of his heart. So now, the reason that God cursed the ground is he says, now, as you look out in the garden, as you look down at the ground, it's going to tell you the condition of your heart. After you have sinned, the vegetable kingdom is now going to show you what's going on in you spiritually. The ground, therefore, was cursed to bring forth thorns and weeds, and as man battled with the hard soil and painful thistles, man would be continually reminded of the evil tendencies in the soil of his heart. So Jesus actually taught this same idea as he explained to his hearers back in Galilee about the four types of heart soil. And we're going to run through these heart soils. And the purpose of this is not to be an intellectual academic exercise. While you're sitting here, I want you somewhere in your notes to write down which one of those heart soils is your heart, okay? And I'm going to ask you at the end of the talk, and I want you to be able to say, I'm not going to ask you to tell me which one, but just that you identify which one, amen? And so I want you to be able to say to yourself, oh, mine is the tared or wheat-choked heart. Mine is the wayside heart. Mine is the good ground heart. Whichever heart it is, I want for you, as we're going through it, to reflect and say, is this, when Jesus was talking about this heart soil, was he talking about you? And I think that some of you will find that we have more than one heart soil. Are you ready? So let's go and take a look and see what the Bible and inspiration says concerning these heart soils. The first one is Luke chapter 8, verse 5, and it says, and when he sowed, some seeds fell by the what? Read it for me. Wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. And that's the Matthew 13, verse 4. In the Luke 8, 5 account, it gives us a little bit more detail. It says, some fell by the wayside, and it was, what's it say in red there? It was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Now, trodden down means that the soil became compacted. It became very hard, and the seed could not penetrate. In Christopic Lessons on page 44, it says, the seed sown by the wayside represents the word of God as it falls upon the heart of an what? Inattentive hearer. Like the hard beaten path trodden down by the feet of men and beasts is the heart that becomes, catch this phrase here, a highway for what? The world's traffics, its pleasures, and sin. Skipping down in white, it says, the spiritual faculties are paralyzed. Men hear the word, but understand it not. They do not discern that it applies to themselves. They do not realize their need or their danger. So the wayside heart is the heart of people who their mind, their mental sensibilities have become hardened and Bible truth resistant. And what has hardened it? What does it say to that very... that second phrase there? Their hearts have become the highway for what? The world's traffic, its pleasures, and its sins. If your mind is filled with the traffic of secular thoughts day and night, Your mind will acquire a condition which makes it harder for spiritual seed to penetrate. People that are on their tablets all day long and they're looking at news and sports and all of these different things, secular thoughts, all day long, they run that through their mind. What happens is the mind becomes resistant to truth. And then when you talk to them about spiritual things, they look at you like, what in the world are you talking about? They lose the capacity for the seed to penetrate. Those secular thoughts actually wars against your spiritual nature. And brothers and sisters, some of the things that we're running through our mind in and of themselves is not wrong. But it is hardening our hearts. Our mind should be on what kind of things? Spiritual things throughout the day. One of my problems is I'm a news junkie. I can sit down and I can read. I'm reading the Nairobi, Kenya newspaper. I'm reading the Soweto Times in South Africa. I'm reading all of these papers, and it's a mistake. If I keep exposing myself to just secular thoughts all day long or reading about things that are not spiritual things, the traffic of these secular thoughts actually hardens the mind. And I find among Seventh-day Adventists who are very educated people that some of them get caught up with a lot of this traffic. One statement says that even children, if you put before them these exciting stories, that it actually destroys the healthy tone of the mind and makes it impossible for them to fix their attention on spiritual things. It says that it actually will pervert their imagination and cause them to think less of Jesus. You know what happens when kids are exposed to a lot of those video games and actually television programs and movies and things, is that they lose the imagination that is necessary to take a book with black and white pages and to paint a picture in their mind. A book becomes unattractive to them. Their intellectual capacity to paint the picture in their mind is lost when it's always painted by somebody else in Technicolor. And we really need to be aware that we will acquire a wayside heart by the traffic of the world. And what's the result of that? Jesus said in Matthew 13, 19, that the people that have the wayside heart, what happens to the seed? Talk to me. What happens to the seed? It's snatched away by who? By the fowls of the air. And Jesus' explanation was that the fowls of the air represent, it says, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away. So they won't understand it. Their minds have hardened so they can't understand spiritual truth. And then the fowls are described by Jesus as the wicked one. That's the evil spirits. That's the enemy. That's Satan that actually snatches away the seed. That's his explanation. Now, who do these birds represent? Who do these birds represent that are snatching away the seed? It's interesting. It represents Satan. That is correct. We know that because Genesis 15, when Abraham had laid out those sacrifices, remember he had the heifers that were laid out and the she-goat and the ram, and he was offering these sacrifices. The Bible says that the fowls of the air came down to attack the carcasses, and Abraham had to war. So who is the one that's trying to attack the atonement of Jesus? That's Satan and his angels. And the Bible teaches us clearly what power is actually snatching away the pure seed of doctrine from people today. Who is doing more than any other power to snatch away that seed? The Bible in Revelation 18 talks about a power called Babylon, which is not only the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit, but it says a cage of every, what does it say there? Unclean and hateful bird. And that's talking about evil spirits. Friends, it's the churches of today, unfortunately, that have become the dwelling place of demons whose specialty is to snatch away the seed of God's word. Let's go on a little further. So hardening our minds, wayside hearts, because of the traffic of the world sets us up to the point where the pure doctrine that comes from the word of God, the seed of God's word, will not be able to take root, and that the powers, the agencies of evil working in false religion will sweep away the truth. The second type of soil that Jesus talked about was the stony ground hearts. In Matthew 13, 5 and 6, it says, some fell upon stony places where, it tells what the problem is, they had not what? I want you to read. They had not what? Much earth. It's a lot of stone, not enough topsoil. And forthwith they sprung up, but because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched because they what? Had no root. They withered away. And Luke 8, 6 adds another comment to that. It says that it sprung up, it withered away because it, what does it say there in blue? It lacked moisture. So if you take the Matthew account and Luke account, there wasn't enough topsoil, where it says no deepness of earth, and it wasn't enough moisture. Jesus' explanation of it in Matthew 13, he said that the stony place heart represents those that they endure for a while, but when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, by and by, the person is offended and they turn. We know that the stony heart represents the unconverted heart. Just from the scriptures alone in Ezekiel 36, he promises that he will give us a new heart and that he'll put within us a new spirit and he'll take away the stony heart out of our flesh. In Christ's Bible Lessons on page 46, it says of the seed sown upon stony ground, it says, middle of the page, it says, like the rock underlying the layer of earth, the selfishness of the natural heart underlies the soil of the good desires and aspirations. It says that the problem is that the love of self is what? So what does it really mean to have a stony ground heart? It means that you're unconverted and that self is alive. Self is alive. And it says that you may be doing a lot of religious things, but you only have a superficial religion. So stony heart soil is someone that on the outside, they appear to have a walk with Christ, but what is alive still that's not been crucified? Self is alive. And when that person, when trial and persecution comes, self rises up and they battle back. And some of us, our problem is that the conversion experience is not deep. And friends, one of the number one signs that we're unconverted is when difficulties come and we lose our peace like that. When a trial or a difficulty comes, you get upset, you get angry, you get agitated instead of staying calm. If you can stay calm under pressure when things are going wrong, then it shows that you are connected to God. But when you start getting upset when things go wrong, when you lose your peace just like that, it's telling you that your conversion experience is faulty. And what happens is we complain. We start complaining when things go wrong. And that is an experience of being a stony heart. Here, let's go on. The thorny ground heart. In Matthew 13, verse 7, it says, and some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. Jesus' explanation in Matthew 13, 22, and then also in Luke 8, 14, he says that he also that received seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world, and the what? Fullness of riches, choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful. In the Luke account, he says that the cares and riches and pleasures of this life actually choke the seed. In Christ's Bible Lessons on page 50, Sermon the Lord comments on the thorny ground heart. And it says that the gospel seed often falls among thorns and noxious weeds, that means poisonous weeds. And if there is not a moral transformation in the human heart, if, what does it say there? If old habits and practices and the former life of sin are not left behind, if the, what does it say there, capital letters? Attributes of Satan are not expelled from the soul, the wheat crop will be choked, the thorns will come to be the crop and will kill out the wheat. This experience of the thorny soil is talking about people who their old habits have not been given up, where the attributes of Satan, some trait of character that was from the former life, remain. Some people we have an experience with God. We have we come to church. We come and get to know the Lord, but we have that hot temper that we don't get over. That moody spirit, that depressed spirit, that quick tongue, or some trait of character from the former life is not. You didn't get the victory over it, and the result of it is your heart becomes choked with thorns. You have the attributes of the enemy. Whenever you have those old habits still lingering on, that's the thorny heart, when you have those attributes of Satan. You can, and just studying from the scriptures alone, you can show that what it says in Christ's Life Lessons, page 50, is true. Because in the Bible talks about the inhabitants of Canaan who were doing great wickedness. The Bible describes them as being T-H-O-R-N-S. It calls them thorns in several places. Here in Numbers chapter 33, the children of Israel were told that if they did not drive out the inhabitants of the land, that they would be pricks in their eyes and thorns in your sides. In another text, it says that they not won't be thorns in your sides, but they will actually be thorns in your what? In your eyes. And you know, did the children of Israel drive out the Canaanites? They did not. And it proved to be correct that it caused them all types of problems. So when the Bible talks about a thorny heart, it's talking about a person who is serving themselves, who's serving the enemy. And Jesus was talking in his parable, he was saying to the people there where he was giving the Sermon on the Mount, he said, if you have seed sown among weeds, among tares, it will choke out the good seed of the word. The ugly pain-causing thorns are actually a symbol of the unregenerate human nature. You know, when plants have thorns, if you have blackberry bushes that have thorns, if you have rose bushes that have thorns, if you have thistles growing in your garden that have thorns in them, those thorns are actually telling you something about your unconverted nature. It's talking about the sinful heart. And the sinful heart always wounds those that are next to it. The sinful heart, it doesn't intend to, it just by its nature, it cuts, it pricks, it angers, it frustrates those that try to labor with it. This is why in the Bible, thorns are used as a symbol of sin. The Bible says that when Abraham offered his son, Isaac, to the Lord, and he was tested and passed the test, that God relieved him of that. And he says that Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and what did he see? A ram. What did it say in yellow there? Read it for me. What did he see? Caught in the thicket. That means caught in the thorn bush. And who did that ram represent? It represents Jesus. And what caught Jesus? What caused Jesus to have to come? It's because of that unregenerate heart. It's because of our thorny nature that he had to come. This is why Jesus actually wore a crown of thorns on his head. Because the great transaction, 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he hath made him to what? Be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made, praise God, what? The righteousness of God in him. That thorny crown that he wore, he was saying, I will become like the chief of sinners. I will take the place that you should take. And all of the things that Jesus suffered on the cross were the things that we should suffer. You know, it is our hands that should be nailed because of what we've done, our feet that should be nailed, our cheeks, the beard should be ripped off, the skin torn because of what we have said. Our back should be whipped because of the burdens that we refuse to carry. And he actually took the place and took the suffering that we should suffer. But praise the Lord, Jesus did not say that the seed of his word would only fall on wayside, on stony ground, And on thorn weed-choked ground, some of the seed falls on good ground. And in Matthew 13:8, it says, but other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Jesus' explanation of that is, he that receives seed in the good ground is he that heareth the word, and what's the next phrase? Understands it, which also, the next phrase? Beareth fruit. And that fruit comes forth in different quantities. So the key for the good ground is to not only understand, but also to bear fruit. Now, in the Bible, we won't study it out now because of our time, but in the Bible, when the Bible says understand, it's just not talking about an intellectual clarity on the subject. In the Bible, understanding is almost always associated with actually putting into action, putting into practice what you are doing. And for example, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that what? That do his commandments. In Psalms 119, 99 and 100, it says, I have more understanding than all my teachers because I keep thy precepts. You know, and over at Psalms 119, verses 99 and 100. In many places, when it talks about understanding, it's talking about you actually putting things into motion. And until it goes into motion, you don't really understand it, according to the Bible term. So when Jesus says that the seed that's received from the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, that understanding is that the seed has taken root and it's growing and it's actually bearing fruit in the experience. And it doesn't say that good ground always, it doesn't say it has zero fruit. It's either, the examples were 100-fold, 60, or 30. It's going to, no matter what, it's going to bear some good fruit. Now, this is a wonderful, wonderful principle. That means that we should be always sowing seed. That wherever you're sowing seed, it will bear some fruit. If there's any good soil at all, it could be 99% wayside soil and just 1% good soil, but where it falls in the good soil, it will bring fruit. That's why in our homes, we should have scripture on the wall. We should have scripture playing on an audio cassette. We should have scripture everywhere before our mind, before our eyes, before our ears, because it will not return unto us. What's what the Bible says in Isaiah 55, verses 10 and 11. Luke 8:15's account of the good soil says, but that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. That's even a little more detailed explanation. That Greek word for patience is hupomene. Everybody say hupomene. Everybody say hupomene. Hupomene. Hupomene means cheerful endurance. It means not only do you endure, but you endure with a smile. That when difficulty comes and you're getting beat up, you say, praise the Lord. Oh, thank you for that rebuke. I love that slap in the face. You actually have cheerful endurance. You endure in a way where your attitude is positive. You know, I was watching a Navy SEAL buds training on YouTube clip, and it was very interesting. The training that they put the Navy SEALs through is extremely, extremely difficult, physically and mentally. And they were interviewing one of the instructors, and he said to the camera, he said, we weed out all of the men with bad attitudes. We only want people that are extremely positive. He said, go ahead, interview them. And these guys, they were making them suffer. I don't know, they were carrying logs. They were laying in the ocean. And they asked them, well, how are you doing? And they were like, we love this. This is great. He was in a lot of pain. He was hurting. He was saying, oh, I can't get enough of this. This is wonderful. And all the guys that murmur and complain, he says, they'll fail. He said, it's so difficult what we're asking them to do. You can't do it while you're complaining. You've got to be positive in your outlook to do something that is extremely difficult. And it's the same with us in our Christian walk. If we're going through our walk and we're complaining, we're murmuring, we have not received the seed in good soil, because the Bible in Luke 8:15 says that they hear the word, they keep it, and they bring forth the fruit with hupomone, with cheerful endurance. When the trial is beating you up, when your money is broke, when everything's going wrong, when they're saying that you're part of a cult and all of these negative things, you will be saying, praise the Lord. Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And that's how you know that the seed is falling into good soil. I'm going to tell you a true story. We were up in Wisconsin, and that was where we had our first, I call it baptism by fire gardening program, because we were not very, we're from the city, didn't know much about gardening. And I remember putting all, my wife and I, all this time and effort into the garden. And I remember one year I was digging in the beds. We were so proud that we had double digged down 24 inches and our garden was real productive. We had corn that was 10 feet tall and it was the talk of the neighbors. And we were like, yeah, God is a blessing. And I remember I was working in this bed that I had worked in for 10 years in that same bed. And as I was digging, my fork hit a stone, hit a rock. I was like, oh, no problem. I just got a rock here. I'll just dig it out. And as I went a little wider with my fork, it was still hitting the rock. And I went a little wider, it was still hitting the rock. Now, I had dug in this bed for years, deeper than that. And I said, there's a huge rock in here that I never discovered. How is that possible? Because I've dug this whole bed back and forth year after year. And when I went to dig the rock out, the rock was about this big around. It was about 18 inches across, and it was a big flat rock like a plate. And when I finally dug it out, I was astounded. And to show you how the human mind works, I was like, who put this rock in my garden? I'm trying to figure out who came and tried to mess up my garden. And I really was baffled about that, and I couldn't figure it out. But you know where that rock came from? Anybody know? You guys probably know, because you... That rock came up from beneath. That rock was down below 24 inches, and every year, the frost, the water that would penetrate, it would just lift it a quarter inch or a half inch. It just lifted a half inch, lifted a half inch. And finally, I'm working in this bed, this thing came up from beneath. And brothers and sisters, that's just like our heart. We have things in our heart. It's deep in us, and we're not even aware of it. And God is trying right now, while probation is still lingering, He's trying to bring it up, so that the great master gardener can do what? Dig it out and get rid of it, so that our hearts can be free and clear. He wants us to be able to not only pass through the trial, but to pass through it praising Him and giving honor to His name, pass through it with cheerful endurance. The Bible calls that patience. And Revelation 14 talks about a people. It says, out of all of the fruit of the Spirit, it only mentions when it says, here is the patience of the saints. Those obedient people have this trait. Like the Navy SEALs, when things are difficult, they'll just say, praise God, bring some more. No problem at all. Keys to having productive heart soil. We're going to go a little deeper now. There are five little steps to heart work that the Bible teaches. Five steps, A, B, C, D, and E. You notice that they are not in order. This text, Hosea 10, verse 12, lists four of them. And the next page, we'll look at the text that mentions the fifth step. And it's interesting, in Hosea 10, verse 12, the Lord inspired Hosea to put them a little bit out of the order that they occur. But the whole text reads like this. Hosea 10:12 says, sow to yourself in righteousness, reap in mercy, break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till He do something. He comes and rains what? Righteousness upon you. Now, the first thing that you do with a garden is not that you sow. If you come to a raw piece of land, what is the first thing that you have to do? You've got to break up the fallow ground. So that's A. That's the thing. And we'll talk about these steps real quickly. You have to break up the fallow ground. What is B, by the way? Here is B over here in Jeremiah 4, verse 3. It mentions A and B. Jeremiah 4, verse 3. Let's read this together. It says, "For thus saith the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground." And what is B? Sow not among thorns. So the first thing that you have to do in the garden of your heart is your heart has to be, if you want to be free from the problems and ready for the good seed, your heart has to be broken up. The second thing, letter B, is what has to be pulled out?
The weeds.
It says the thorn. Because you can sow not among thorns. We're going to back this up. The third thing is you put in the good seed of God's word. That's letter C. And then after you've prepared the soil, you've taken out the weeds, you put in the good seed, then you have to pray that the Lord will send rain. Or you can water artificially your garden, and he's going to come and rain his spirit. He's going to rain righteousness upon you. And that whole process is described in Hosea 10:12, is you seeking the Lord. The process of, it's time for you to seek the Lord. How is that done? He breaks up the fallow ground. He asks you to pull out the thorns. He asks you to sow in the good seed. And then he comes and reigns. And when he rains his righteousness on you, when he puts his spirit in you, you will bear fruit. And how do you get the soil of your heart broken up? In Micah chapter 4, it talks about the fact that time is coming in the last days when they shall beat their, what does it say there, capital letters?
Swords
into plowshares. And so the blade on a plow, the Bible talks about a time when that blade will be made up of a sword. And that sword, of course, what is the sword of the Spirit? Ephesians 6:17. What's the sword of the Spirit?
The Bible.
The word of God is the sword of the Spirit. So it's the Bible truths that are used to break up the soil of the heart. Charles Finney, who was the founder of Oberlin College, who was one of the last of the faithful, true Protestants before Protestantism became corrupt, had a powerful experience. I don't know if many of you know the story of Charles Finney, but Charles Finney had an unusual ability to bring people under the conviction of sin through casual conversation. The Spirit was heavily upon this man. The story is told, true story, of him going into a factory. He was well known in the town that he lived in. He went into a factory here in Ohio. And there were two women near the door of the factory. One was telling a joke, and he just looked at her, and she stopped in mid-sentence, and he walked over to her and talked to her very softly for just a few sentences. And then she began confessing her sins right there on the spot. And then others came and joined, so much that the owner of the factory said, "Shut down all the machines. We're going to have church in here right now. This is more important than that product." That's the kind of experience Charles Finney had. And he wrote a book called The Revivals of Religion in 1868. And in this book, I was reading it recently, he has a whole chapter about the subject of how is the heart broken up? How do you break up your heart? I can't read all this. This is deep. He says, if you mean to break up the fallow ground of your heart, you must begin by looking at your hearts, examine and note the state of your mind. Comes down to the bottom sentence here. He says, to do all of this, you must set yourself to the work of considering your sins. You must examine yourself. He says, you got to look at your life. You have to consider your actions. He actually says, take up your individual sins one by one. He says, take a piece of paper and pen and start trying to write down your sins one by one. He says, as you start writing these things down, he says, other ones will come to your mind. And as they come to your mind, he says, start praying and saying, God, take this from me. Take it out of me. You know what, friends and sisters? When I read this, I said, all right, I'm a Christian. I'm going to do this. And I went and I got a piece of paper, and I went by myself in my little mobile home where I live. And it was a painful experience. And I began to pray, and God began to show me things. I said, Lord, I really want to know what my heart condition is. I want to know, Lord. I want everything in my heart to be free and clear. I had to put the paper down. God was bringing so many things to my mind. And it says that when you do this, he says, your sins were committed one by one. And as far as you can come at them, they ought to be reviewed and repented of how? One by one. He said, this is how you break up the fallow ground of our heart. This is the work that's supposed to be going on now in the Day of Atonement that is not going on among us as a people. And we have these things that are just clinging to us that we can't get rid of. In Finney's book, he gives a list. Let me give you some suggestions of areas that you can look at. And from pages 35 to 38, he lists over four pages of what he calls sins of omission. He says ingratitude, neglect of the Bible, neglect of prayer. He says want of love for our fellow men, neglect of your family duties, neglect of your social duties. Neglect of self-denial. He starts listing these things, and he has a paragraph on each of them where he's starting to break it down. When you start going through that list, you're saying, oh, my word, Lord, I need to have a change in my experience. So if you want your heart to be broken up, we're not talking about some just, oh, Lord, I'm going to say a little 10-minute prayer at the end of my day, and I'll be okay. In order for us to have our hearts broken up, in order for us to be good ground hearers, we've got to spend some time. We've got to get away from other people. We've got to get away from distractions, alone with the Lord, and ask him to reveal himself to us. The Bible says that some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down. If you were to go down this path right here and just start sowing a lot of seeds there, only a few would take root, because that ground, that path, is very hard. And what's the result of that hard ground? What will happen to the seed that's sown on hard ground? The fowls of the air will come and devour it. I have come to believe, I didn't believe it at first, but I've come to believe that the electronics explosion of the smartphone and the tablet is doing more than any other thing to harden the hearts of this generation. I'm the youth teacher at my church, and it's amazing the power that the smartphone has on the mind of teenagers today. And they cannot, many of them cannot hold it in their hand without looking at it. They cannot have it in their possession without their attention being drawn to it. I've tried many different things. They'll say, well, I'm using it to look up the Bible. It's gotten to the point now, you will not use it to look up the Bible. You will use a paper Bible. Because I found that when we go to paper Bibles, they cannot find the book in the Bible because they're used to touching the book on the screen. They're losing their ability to use a paper Bible. I have them check their phones in when we come to youth prayer meeting because I find that it's too powerful a distraction for them. They cannot help but look at it. So I confiscate it from them. And this is how the enemy is hardening the minds, not just of Americans, all over the world, in third world countries, in Africa. They're all getting smartphones. And they're all spending their time. This is a flip phone here, but it doesn't matter. It's just something to distract their mind from the Bible. Even children want to have these electronic devices. They feel that they have the right. Oh, I could tell you some stories. We were taking care of our granddaughter, and we were having problems. She wasn't doing her schoolwork. And finally, I said, you know what? You're not listening to me. So give me your guitar. Give me your mobile phone. Give me a... And I took all of her things from her. I said, you know, when you start to see that what I'm saying to you is important, then I'll give you your stuff back. And she went to school the next day, and when she came back, she said, Daddy, do you know what the kids would tell? I'll never let my parents take. I said, well, they don't live with me. And if they live with me, I'll take their phone too. Nobody gonna live in this house and be the captain of this ship. You're not running this house. Mama and I are running this house. And you're not going to run your own program in our house. You're going to have to run God's program in here. But what's happening with children now is that the peer pressure is such where they feel that, hey, all the other kids are doing this, so we need to be doing it also, and it is a mistake. The results of that having a heart like that is that your heart soil will lack moisture. And that moisture, of course, is the rain of God's Spirit. The rain of His Spirit. Jesus said in John chapter 14, I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another Comforter. And He came down in verse 18. He said that He would send Him. He says, and I will come to you. The Comforter, it's Jesus coming to us through the power of the Holy Spirit. And if you allow your mind to be hardened with the traffic of the world, you will lose the moisture of God's Spirit. Hosea chapter 6, verse 3. We're almost at our end. Hold on. It says, then shall we know if we follow on another Lord. His going forth is prepared as the morning, and He, Jesus, shall come unto us as the rain, as the latter and former rain unto the earth. That's what we're missing. We're missing the Spirit. We're missing Jesus in our life when we allow our hearts to be hardened. How do we get that Spirit? I'm going to talk about this in our last parable this afternoon. I'll just mention it here quickly in Luke 11, 13, which is the last part of a whole. It's the last verse in a very interesting parable. Jesus says, if ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the what? To them. That was the last two words. Let me tell you something, friends. You will not have the Spirit of God in your life unless you ask for Him. When do you ask for Him? You ask for Him during your prayer time. And during your prayer time, you have to actually ask and say, God, give me your Holy Spirit. And I read something interesting. When I first read it, because my wife and I are studying the subject of prayer and many different authors, and when I first read it, I didn't believe it. But the more I studied, it became clearer and clearer. What the author said, he said, the Holy Spirit is given only during the time of prayer. And the author that I was reading, he said, if you only spend a little bit of time in prayer, God can only put just a few little sprinkles of His Spirit in your life. You have to spend a longer period of time for Him to pour it into your life. And the author quoted this text. It says, the Holy Spirit is given to them that ask Him. And when I began to meditate on that, I said, Lord, the reason why I don't have more of your Spirit, the reason that when I talk to people, they don't come under conviction, the reason that when I preach and when I share, people are not convicted, is because your Spirit doesn't dwell in me more fully like it dwelt in Charles Finney, like it dwelt in Elijah, like it dwelt in Jesus, where when He talked to people, they immediately came under conviction. So the problem is that we have to start praying longer, deeper, harder, and ask and plead and say, Lord, I want your Spirit. Amen? Amen. And Acts 5:32 says that the Holy Spirit is given to them that obey Him. So we have to have some heart work done in order for Him to hear that prayer. We come down to the close of our study this afternoon. And it's no great mystery if you have an evil nature fighting with a good nature, which nature will win if you observe how the natures are treated. And if we would liken the evil, unregenerate nature unto a black dog and the regenerate new heart nature to a white dog, and don't get me wrong, I'm not against black or anything like that, but if we were liking the unconverted nature to the black dog and the regenerate nature to a good dog, it is the dog that is fed that will win. And I'll add a corollary to that. The evil nature of man has become so powerful now in this last remnant of time that feeding the spiritual nature is not enough. The evil nature must also be starved. You have to feed one and starve the other. And that's the time that we're living in this earth's history. And unfortunately, most Christians, they feed the regenerate nature and they throw a few bones to the evil nature. And if you give the evil nature just a tidbit of dog food, it rises in strength. And know what you have when you do that? Well, you're trying to study your Bible, you're trying to pray, but you're also feeding a little bit of the carnal nature, you have a tremendous battle. And most Christians today, they're conflicted. In their minds, there's this tremendous warfare. They're trying to feed the regenerate nature the most, but they're still throwing a little dog food to the carnal nature. And if you feed both, you're doomed. You have to feed the good, feed the white, and do what? Starve what color? Starve the black. I actually wrote a poem. I'm not going to read. I'm only going to read one verse of it, two verses of it. Save ourselves time. Two verses of the poem. It's called The Great Dog Fight. Two dogs each day came out to fight. The one was black, the other white. One master owned the dueling pair and supervised the whole affair. Each dog with perfect hate and spite would bark and claw, would lunge and bite. Each nail and tooth they did employ their canine rival to destroy. And the poem goes on to say that this person was doing really well. The white dog was getting strong. The black dog was getting weak. And the black dog was almost vanquished. But in the poem, they start feeding the black dog. And it turns into this huge fight, this huge brawl. And that is why our heart soil is in the condition that it is. Jesus has told us what we need to do. He says that we've got to break up our fallow ground. Sow not among thorns, Jeremiah 4:3. He says we have to put that good seed in and that he will come and rain righteousness upon you. We've got to completely starve that unregenerate nature. We've got to say, where is he coming in to my home? Where is he coming in to my mind? Where is he getting access to my children and my family? And every door we have to shut off and then feed lavish spiritual food upon the spiritual nature. I used to wake up in the morning when I had my granddaughter with me. We were having all of these battles. I would wake up before her and before she would come on, I would turn on some calm Christian music. When she woke up in the house, the first thing she heard before she could even open her eyes was some beautiful Christian music just wafting into her room, caressing her attitude before she rolled out of those warm blankets for another battle with grandma and grandpa. So we need to be trying to establish an environment that is feeding the spiritual nature, and we must starve that unregenerate nature. We must choke out those weeds of the heart so that we can have the good soil heart. How many of you have identified which one of those soils you have present? And don't tell me which one, but you've identified which ones are present in your experience, and you know a little bit more of what you should do. Okay, we're thankful for your hands. Kneel with us as we close out in prayer. Our gracious Father in heaven, we are thankful that out of all 47 parables, that you spent time explaining to us about the soil of our heart. Oh Lord, all of the thorns that we see in the garden today are shouting at us of our own condition. Oh Lord, many of us here have wayside hearts, hearts choked with thorns, stony heart that doesn't have much depth of earth or moisture. Lord, many of us have just a few drops of your spirit, because our prayer life is so brief and shallow. Oh, Lord, we repent this afternoon. Help us to make time to have our hearts broken up and prepared for the seed of your word. Lord, we want to bring forth fruit, not only 30, 60, and 100-fold, but with hupomene in our hearts, with cheerful endurance. We want to be able to praise you in the midst of the trial. We want others to see that you have peace that passes all understanding. We want people to see that we're not stressed by the economic conditions, by the deplorable moral conditions in the world today, because you've prepared an escape for us and for all who will bring their lives in alignment with your will. Bless us today. Help us to have our hearts renewed and changed so that we can be those people in which the seed bears bountifully. To your name's honor and glory is our prayer we ask in Jesus' mighty name, and all the people said together, amen.